Welcome
to
a work
in progress
with Mark and Pete.
That's us.
That's us. We are Mark and Pete. You have to guess who's who.
And we couldn't be happier to be here chatting with you guys.
Yeah.
It's an absolute honor.
It's
a one-way
conversation, but
yeah.
Because you guys aren't commenting.
Comment more. Nah, do whatever you want.
Just
dude.
Kidding. Yeah.
Just have
just
a great time.
To it. It's cool.
Just enjoy your life.
I do have quite a few people text me about it, though.
You do?
Yeah.
You mentioned you have some people interested in shirts already?
Yeah.
Was that because at the end of the last one we talked about, like,
yeah,
if we sold some shirts or something?
Yeah.
That's cool.
And one of my buddies, Mitch, who I'm sure is going to listen to this. I love you so much, Mitch. He said he'd be the first one to buy.
Oh, awesome.
And then I mentioned it to some other people, and they're like, oh, totally, I would wear one.
Okay, well, I do have a lady that does t-shirts for me from the gym.
Mm.
And we just got to come up with a couple designs.
I know a guy.
And I'll send them to her, and we just got to get a, what is better is if we get an order ahead of time. So this is what I think we should do. Come up with the designs.
Yeah.
Maybe a couple different colors. We'll post it on whatever pages we have.
Yeah.
And then we'll get orders in, and then we'll order the shirts, and then we'll figure out ways to get them to the people.
Sounds good.
Yeah, I think we can make it work. Make it happen.
We can personally deliver them all.
That would be kind of fun.
Mitch lives in California.
We can't do that. Sorry, Mitch.
I might consider going out and visiting Mitch.
You should do it, and then you can hand deliver his shirt.
And we can hand deliver.
We could do hats. I think hats would be nice too.
Like those sweepstakes things.
What?
Like with
the big check?
But just like have a shirt with balloons and like people cheering.
Yeah.
And each person's
house. Oh, we have like the giant check. But instead of like monetary whatever, it just says a shirt.
A shirt.
A shirt. That's it.
That's it. You won.
Yeah. Also, you owe us $20. You drive all the way or fly to California to tell Mitch $20.
$20.
Doesn't even come close to covering the airfare or the gas to get there.
Oh, that's so funny. How's your week been?
Really good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, some challenging things, just like I think one of the hardest things for me as a human, which now translates to parenthood, is adjusting my momentum or my plan for the day. And that's always been a struggle for me, as if like, if this like A, B, and C is happening and I know I need to do like X, Y, and Z next, and I'm kind of getting that momentum. If something like comes in like, hey, actually this just came up.
Yeah.
Even if it's not like a hard or difficult thing to do, just the switch mentally has always been like a, but I was going to get this done and that done. And I feel like the challenging part is because in my head, what I was planning on doing next is already done.
Mm.
I just need to get there.
Yeah.
And now I can't get there because this came in the way.
Yeah.
And so that is just it's just a skill or practice of like being okay with that occurrence I really struggle with.
Mm.
Like recently, Henry was having kind of a fussy day or whatever. And it's like, okay. And it was Shireen's day off from work. So I was like trying to do stuff at the gym. But it just was too much. So I went home and like took Henry. And then thankfully my mom was able to watch him so that we both could do the things that we had.
Yeah.
But that like for a while I had to basically take him and like, and that comes up all the time with a toddler or kids is things that you weren't expecting.
You have to be flexible.
I'm not flexible. It's like, I want my day to be scheduled or if I have free time, I want it to be free time.
Yeah.
And then when things change, it's that friction of that. I got to work on being flexible.
I think back to like before I had kids and before I was married.
Yeah.
I must have wasted so much time.
Dude, and the problem with that is because I've had this line of thought. You can't go to people who don't have kids.
Oh, yeah.
And plead with them, please be productive.
Not at all.
You have so much time. You don't even realize. You can get a full night's sleep when you want. You just got to go to bed earlier.
You just got to go to bed.
And like, I want to do that to my younger brothers, but it's like, they don't have the experience to know that they should be using it in this way.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And like me, when I was in that stage, I was convinced that I was like using my time effectively.
Yeah.
But it just still felt like I couldn't get stuff done.
Yeah. Isn't it wild?
And now I'm getting the same amount done that I did then.
Yeah.
But I'm also a husband and father.
I heard a saying once that nobody is more productive than a mother that's given 30 minutes of freedom.
Oh, wow.
And it's like, yeah, because she's always juggling like five things usually, right? And so when she has time to not have to like watch kids or, you know, do something like that.
Totally.
It's just like, okay, so I can do boom, boom, boom. And it's not like, oh, let me go relax now. It's like, now I have time to be productive. Yeah. That's it.
Yeah. That's totally the way April is.
Yeah.
I struggle. I'm not that way.
Yeah.
Like 30 minutes, sweet.
Nap time. No, that's me too. If I get a break, I usually try and catch up on some sleep. But, I think that that line of thought of you can't like convince people to like utilize their time better if they don't have kids. It's very similar to like trying to convince a child like or explain to them how good they have it. Like you can't explain to them the burden and responsibility of an of adulthood because it doesn't translate. But you want to go to like teenagers in high school and be like, hey, be so present
seriously
that you can soak in every minute of your life right now because
enjoy every second of this.
This is it. I mean, there's so much joy in adulthood too, but it's different.
Well, I mean, to be fair, that's what a lot of people say to people in our stage of life.
What's that?
Have like small kids. It's like, be extra present, pay attention, enjoy these moments because they're going to pass so quickly.
Yeah.
And I know that in a blink, my kids are going to be older and I'm going to be like, dang, I wish I would have paid more attention.
I try and be nostalgic with Shireen like that sometimes to help her be present, but she just gets mad at me. So I'll be like, there'll be like kind of a cute or fun moment or whatever with Henry.
Yeah.
And I'll be like, man, like, before we know it, he's going to be going to prom in high school. And she's like, stop it.
He's never going
Don't
to prom.
Don't say that.
he's always going to be a kid.
And it's funny. She like doesn't want to put that in her head because she wants to enjoy it now.
Absolutely.
But that's how my brain works is if I think of, oh, this is going to come before I know it, let me be present now because it's going to be gone so quick.
Yeah.
But yeah. It's
this morning, April was holding all three of the kids. Mm. And so we have a four-month-old, a four-year-old, and a six-year-old. And Sophia, our six-year-old, I took a picture and she was like, I'm the biggest kid here. And she was like, yeah, you're a big kid. She said, yeah, I'm like an adult. And we were both like, whoa.
Hold on.
No.
Hold the phone.
You will never be an adult.
Never. You're not allowed.
You will be our baby.
It makes me think of, have you seen Adam Sandler? Gosh, which movie is it? I think it's Billy Madison.
I'm sure I've seen it, but I don't remember.
Okay, anyways. So he basically, he's dumb and he gets his dad super rich, so he gets to go through school.
Yeah.
So he goes back to school to prove that he can pass all the grades. Anyways, so he's in like fifth grade with a bunch of like fifth graders or fourth grade and whatever. And there's like this real chubby kid. And he's like, the kid is like, boy, I can't wait till I get to be a grown up. And Adam Sandler, Billy Madison in the movie, he goes and he like takes his face. He's like, don't you ever say that. Stay here as long as you can. Cherish it. Cherish it. You know, he's like flapping his cheeks because he's like, cherish it. And it's so funny, but it's also super true. It's like, you gotta soak it up.
Why are people like that? And I say people, I include myself entirely in that, is that we're so excited for the next phase of life.
Yeah.
We're always looking forward and not looking with the here and now.
I don't know. I would assume it's something to do with how our brains are wired. But I think it's important to focus on being present.
Yeah.
And maybe that's like a huge piece of life is just like wherever you're at.
Yeah.
Be present there. Because if we're telling younger kids to be present and people that are older than us are telling us to be present, you can take it on good faith that like, that's kind of the move.
Yeah.
Like whatever, wherever you're at in life, take a deep breath and soak it all in. Cause if it's good or bad or whatever, it's going to be gone.
Yeah.
Pretty quick.
I wonder if people like in their 90s are telling people in like their 70s to be present.
Probably. People I mean, that's still 70s, a 20 year gap. And I think one thing that Gary Vee does really well, I know we talked about him recently. He talks about how much time we have. And that it's way different than like, you know, centuries ago when people lived to be like 40 or 50.
Yeah.
Like a lot of us are living to be at least 70, 80, 90, given there's no tragedy or like health thing. And so many times we're like, you see people who are in their 30s or 40s are like, dude, I'm done. I'm finished. I should have started when I was 18 when I had time. It's like,
so much.
If you're 40, you still have one more full round of that.
Yeah.
Like you can restart from zero.
Yeah.
You have 40 years, you know, maybe more.
Yeah.
Like that's a long time.
Even in a career. I mean, yeah. By 40, you're only like halfway through working.
Yeah.
Like through your working.
Yeah. You've been working for 20 years. You got another 20 to go. It's like,
yeah,
man, you can course correct. I feel like one of the issues with like modern like careers, mm-hmm, is we look into the past of how people used to be. Mm. And what it used to be was you go to high school, go to college to learn whatever, and then you go get a job and you work that job for 40 years and you get a gold watch and a pension.
Yeah.
That does not happen anymore.
Yeah.
It's not realistic. It's not, just doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. Maybe a couple companies exist, but it's rare.
Yeah.
And with that mindset of looking in the past, it's so stressful for some people who are 10 years into a job because they know that job really well. Mm. Maybe they're comfortable and, you know, but they're not content and they're not progressing and they really don't like it at all.
Yeah.
But they think they're stuck because, oh, I need to be doing this for another 30 years.
Yeah.
Where you can course correct.
Yeah.
You got the time. There's so many resources now this day and age. Like it's the mindset of I need to keep doing this even though it's not for me, you know?
Yeah.
And I think I reflected on this already, but my brother Ben, when I was in a really, really dark spot and I called him and we were talking, him just kind of giving me permission to be like, because I was really stressing about the gym at that point. And he was like, you realize you can course correct. Like the goals you had when you were 20, those don't have to be your goals when you're 30. Like you can ebb and flow. And that comes back to flexibility, something I need to work on, right? So being flexible with your goals and your standards and stuff like that so that you can take where you're at currently in life and make adjustments to make your future better.
That's a scary thing though.
Oh, terrifying for
like
most people.
Especially like if you have a family.
Yeah.
That like you're at least partially providing for.
Yeah.
Like to say, nah, I'm going to try to do something else.
Yeah.
And that, but those fears just lock us into.
I think that's it. Yeah. It's a big, and it's a logical fear too. Mm-hmm. It's not like saying like, ah, don't be silly. Like just take the leap. It's like, no, like there's things to think about here. Like mortgages need to be paid. You know, food needs to be in the fridge, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Makes sense.
You're absolutely right.
But I think most of the good stuff in life is on the other side of fear and struggle. So.
Ooh, that's good.
The life you want is right on the other side of all the things you don't want to do.
Mm.
That's it.
Ba-doom-choo.
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 I was thinking of, I don't know why this popped in my head. I was thinking of like a tagline for like our podcast.
Yeah. What would it be?
You tell me what you like better, but
okay.
I like either a podcast about nothing, but also everything or a podcast about nothing, but also, wait.
Everything. You said that one.
Did I say that one? Or a podcast about everything, but also nothing at all.
Oh. Ooh.
So it's everything, nothing, but order. Which one comes first, like the order of it?
Nothing. Podcast about everything. I like the podcast about nothing.
Yeah.
But also everything.
I think I like that better. Mm. Yeah. So podcast about nothing. It makes me think of Seinfeld. Yeah, it's a show about nothing.
Yeah.
We're the Seinfeld of podcasts.
The Seinfeld.
You're welcome. You guys wanted more? You wanted season 10 of Seinfeld?
Yeah.
Here you go.
Here you go.
This is it.
This is
the restaurant scene over and over and over and over again.
I was going to do a Jerry Seinfeld impersonation.
Please.
Nah, it's all right.
No.
We don't need to do that to anybody.
That's disappointing. I wanted to see it.
My Seinfeld impersonation is not Jerry Seinfeld. I'll just do no soup for you.
The soup Nazi? The
soup Nazi.
Yeah, there you go.
There you go. You're welcome. You're welcome.
All right. We get a little snippet.
I'll sign all the t-shirts.
Dude, we could do hey, we're going to be huge one day. You laugh. We have to manifest it. Make it real. This podcast is going to be number one. and
set up in downtown Cedarburg with a booth.
We're gonna have limited edition
signings,
first edition shirts that are signed by us.
Wow!
And then we'll sell them, and then people will be like putting them in like glass cases and stuff on their wall. Be like, hey, I got a first edition autograph signed T-shirt from the Mark and Pete.
From the Mark and Pete.
Podcast about nothing, but also everything.
But also everything. The tagline I could, the only tagline I thought of was a work in progress. We are a work in progress.
No, I don't like that at all.
That's not a tagline. It's just a doubling down on the title.
Yeah.
Yeah. I really like that. A podcast about nothing, but also everything.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Except landscaping, apparently.
No. We could have somebody on. Everything we don't cover.
I'm really excited to have like other people on and like talk about their lives and stuff.
Thing I was thinking about doing is since we need a new, what is that called?
An interface.
A new interface so that we can get extra mics. Because right now our interface only does two microphones. The last time when we did with the Gems of History podcast, mm-hmm. Jacob and Evan, they brought their interface so that mm-hmm. we could do four. So ours is only two and we want to start having guests on. So what we could do is like a mini fundraiser for a new interface.
Ooh.
And part of it can be the t-shirts and maybe hats or whatever merch we want to do.
That's a really good idea.
And then we can hopefully get a new interface.
Boom. And then start having guests.
And having guests. We could even do like
landscaping. I'm so excited to talk about landscaping.
You know what would be fun?
What?
We do like a threshold of like, if you donate so much, you get to be a guest.
Ooh.
That's an idea.
Wow.
It's a thought.
Make people pay to be guests on our
show. Well, if you want to be part of it.
Yeah.
And if you want to be part of it, maybe you want to be part of it like physically.
Make history.
Yeah.
There's going to come a day when Gems of History is going to do a show on us.
That means no. Well, I mean, we're actually planning on going on their podcast.
I'm super coming excited up soon. About that.
I'm really looking forward to it.
I have no idea what I will be able to contribute.
Yeah. But so this is a little teaser. We had Jacob and Evan on for Gems of History a couple podcasts back, and we will be having them back, or we'll be going on their show.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll see us in their environment.
We're going to be talking about a gem of history.
Yeah. Normally they don't record their whole thing. So hopefully they'll let us pull up a camera so we can get there.
So we'll do we'll still video record and post.
If they let us.
Mm.
But normally they just do the audio, I think.
Yeah.
So that'll be fun though.
Yeah. Hopefully we can convince them.
Yeah.
We'll see. Yeah. So how you feeling?
Dude. Wow. I feel incredible.
So to give some context, Peter's been doing this challenge thing at the gym called Compete with Pete.
Yes.
And he has challenged people in the gym to compete with his, I don't know, I'll let you pitch it. What is it? It's like your...
So I'm going to back up.
Please do.
And so I recently turned 30 and at that point I had not been taking care of myself.
Mm.
And I was just, I know we've talked about it here, but you could see it if you go back and listen to the podcast. I've been going through like waves of anxiety, depression,
mm-hmm.
ups and downs for a while now. And I'm the guy at the gym who's preaching like eat healthy, exercise for not just physical health, but also your mental health, and not doing what I said, not like leading by example. So I took my 30th birthday as an opportunity to like turn a new leaf and start over, start fresh, begin again. And a way to stay on track, because there are withdrawal symptoms that mm-hmm. come with that, with going from eating junk food to eating healthy again. Or like I had been drinking fairly regularly socially with parties and family events, all sorts of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I cut alcohol out completely.
Mm.
The only advice that I'm keeping is caffeine, because part of the withdrawals is exhaustion.
Yeah.
So like to continue doing my day to day, I was like, okay, caffeine isn't like detrimental in any way, I don't think. So I kept my coffee and my caffeine.
This might be a silly question, but are there like healthier types of caffeine than others?
Actually, that's actually probably a great question. I don't know. Like if coffee or green tea or whatever derivatives.
Like I'm assuming like better. A cup of coffee is better than like an energy drink or something like that.
Yeah, but that's because of what else is in it.
Yeah.
Right.
So caffeine.
Yeah, that makes sense. But I would assume, which is a dangerous thing to do, that the caffeine molecule itself mm-hmm. is probably the same when derived from mm-hmm. different things. It's probably what surrounds it.
Yeah, that
makes it good or bad. That's my guess.
Yeah.
But anyway, so I decided to, because I own a gym and we got like 95 members. And
it's an awesome gym.
Thank you. 40 so people good. Signed up to compete against me.
Mm-hmm.
So what it is we did a weigh-in that checks your weight, your body fat percentage, and then we did just a waistline tape measure.
Mm.
And 30 days, I gave everybody like meal plans and stuff for the whole 4 weeks or 30 days. And we're going to see who can get the most improved as far as those three criteria mm-hmm. in 30 days. So we did the first weigh-ins, and then 30 days from that, we'll do the finals.
Mm.
So we're like 10 days in. It's essentially the month of July yeah. that we're doing it. And I've like, apart from the first day when I had some chips, I have not cheated at all as far as food goes. I haven't had any alcohol. I haven't had any like added sugar. I've been eating like really, really clean.
Has that gotten easier as time goes on?
Yes. So one thing that is actually a great thing to go through again was the withdrawals from... So I was getting withdrawals from like junk food, which includes like sugar and grains. Like grains are addictive. Mm. Dairy is actually addictive. Added sugars are addictive. Mm. And then alcohol, right? Yeah. So I wasn't like drunk on a regular basis, yeah. but I was regularly drinking.
Yeah.
So that can lead to things too. Anyway, so cutting all that out cold turkey, no joke, like the first four-ish days of being eating clean and everything, very, very dark place in my head.
Yeah.
Serious withdrawals, exhaustion, headaches, suicidal thoughts in my head, like, I don't want to do this anymore. I don't want to be here. All the like typical, like you're in depression, deep, dark spot, like that was full force, all there. And the only reason I was able to push through that, I feel like, was because I made it a promise to myself, but also the competition of like, I told everybody I'm going to do this and I don't want to lose.
Yeah.
And this is it. Like I feel like I've made multiple excuses in my 20s because there's something to fall back on. Like, well, I'm only 20, whatever.
Yeah.
And I have time to figure it out.
Mm.
But I'm married and I'm a father, and there's promises that I've made that I want to keep.
Mm.
And now that I know 30 isn't like old, but it's, I'm a grown man. Mm. I need to be accountable, and I can't keep making these same excuses, and I'm done.
Mm.
It was just a line in the sand. Like, this is it.
Mm.
I'm cleaning up my act and I'm leading by example starting now. And that's why I made it into the competition is so that I'm accountable, not just to myself where I can just quit. I'm accountable to all these people.
Yeah.
So all that to say, once I got like 4 days in, I started feeling a little bit better. Mm. 5 days in, significantly better. A week in, very good.
Mm.
And now I'm, what is the date today? The 11th or 10th?
Today is the 11th.
Okay. So I feel amazing. Mm-hmm. And it, in hindsight, so worth that dark withdrawal period to go through to get where I am today. Like, my motivation is back. Mm. My clarity in my head is back. My excitement to get like my stuff in order is back.
Mm.
My joy, like the happiness, I feel like is way different from a joy. Happiness is temporary because you had a chocolate bar, you're happy.
Yeah.
Someone you have a crush on, if you're single, they're talking to you, you're happy.
Mm-hmm.
Like little things like that. You get coffee, you're happy.
Mm-hmm.
Those are little bumps of happiness, which is good. That's fine. But joy is like in your heart and like you can feel it, and it like keeps you going. And it's like, if something bad happens, it's okay because I have this joy.
Mm.
And that was gone for a long time and it's back, and I almost want to cry. Like,
that's amazing.
And it makes me want to shout from the rooftops to like, it reminds me why I started the gym.
Mm.
I started the gym because I used to feel this way all the time.
Yeah.
Because I was eating really healthy. I was exercising regularly. I had community from people at the gym. All these things that I put to the backside in as an excuse of, I have a gym to run. I'm a wife, or I'm a husband and a father. mm-hmm. so I don't have time. The switch is now flipped to, I have a gym to run. I'm a husband and a father. I need to do this so that I can fulfill my role in all this capacity.
Yeah.
And it just feels, I can't even put it into words, but way better, significantly better.
That's awesome. Can you talk to, because I know the struggle for a lot of people is, especially a lot of people in the same stage of life as us, is that their husbands, their fathers, their full-time employees and or employers. And it's hard to do that when you're doing this, especially being married and having kids. Mm-hmm. Like that is, I mean, that's an excuse that I lean on a lot and a lot of people lean on a lot is, is sure, I could do this if I was a single guy.
Yeah.
But I have a partner and these other kids that I have to try to convince of too, and they're going to want to eat other stuff than me.
Yep.
So how do you work it with that?
First of all, I would say that those are excuses. Some excuses are valid. And in certain circumstances, maybe that can't be overcome, but I would say that on the surface level is just a lie. 99% of excuses are just lies to keep us from figuring out how to do the thing that we know we should do. Also, the majority of people, members at the gym, are spouses and parents and full-time employees, and they figure it out.
Yeah.
Some people amaze me. Some people drive from 20, 25 minutes away every day. Some people bring their clothes and they come right after work. Some people wake up. I mean, we have classes as early as 5 a.m. to account for schedule issues. Hey, I can't do it. Okay, what about 5 a.m.? Well, I just don't want to wake up that early. Okay, so now it's not a you can't, it's a you don't want to, right? So it's anybody who wants something can get it if they're willing to, you know, ask questions, ask for help, move things around, make it a priority. Ultimately, it's a priority issue.
Yeah.
So I like the example of I don't have time, right? Okay, your basement is flooding and all of your valuables are down there, all of your nostalgic memories. Are you going to continue sitting on the couch playing on your phone? Or are you going to go get all of your stuff out of the basement before it's ruined?
Yeah, absolutely. Go and get the stuff.
All of a sudden you have time because that is your number one priority. Right? If you have kids and they're at a friend's house and all of a sudden there's an emergency and they need you, guess who has time to go pick them up? Guess who has time all of a sudden?
Yeah.
And I think we paint a picture of this huge mountain in our head that is impossible to overcome so that we don't even have to try and climb. Whereas it's not that big of a mountain. You just have to start. Since I talk about this stuff all the time, I'm going to ramble a lot and say a lot of things just because it's what I'm passionate about. Yeah. And I also know different avenues of things that I've talked about before. So I apologize in advance for talking very much, but it's a podcast and we're talking.
That's what we're supposed to do on a podcast. Okay. I think
a huge issue is motivation, right? And it's confusing. People have it backwards. A lot of people will say, I want to be healthy. I just am not motivated. And they wait for motivation to come. Motivation comes after you start and you get some momentum going and you go for a week and you're just like, okay, this isn't as bad as I thought. I'm a little sore, but it kind of feels good because I know I'm getting stronger.
Yeah.
Oh, all of a sudden I'm down 2 pounds. What if I get down to 5 pounds down? Yeah. Your clarity starts coming back. Once you get through that initial struggle of like schedule change and everything, the momentum is crazy.
Yeah.
And that's when you get motivated to go. There are people who will not miss a day at the gym because they have that motivation, not because they sat around waiting for it, but because they started and then they got momentum and it motivates them.
Yeah.
So instead of waiting, which will not, if you are waiting for motivation to come to do something you know you need to do, you will be waiting until you're in the grave and it will not come. Because maybe you'll see a video that's like, oh, you know what? I really should, squirrel. Oh, you know what? This is kind of exciting and makes me feel like maybe I could be like this, squirrel.
Or you like it. I'll go back and look at that later.
Yeah. No, it's... You have to struggle through the beginning. You just have to start. I mean, as much as Nike's probably not the best company, just do it, man. Mm. Just do it. You have to start.
Also a decent tagline.
It's great. It's great. It's probably the, it's probably one of the best.
Yeah.
But the struggle at the beginning, not only is it just part of it, if you go into it knowing like, I'm just going to go into this struggling a little bit, it's not as daunting because we have perfectionist mindsets of, well, I have to be perfect my first day. No, 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 no. Are you perfect at a job you've been doing for 10 years? No, you screw up.
Yeah.
So go into it knowing it's okay to do it wrong. It's okay to do it poorly. It's okay to struggle and then learn and adapt and grow and push. And I think that's a big piece of it too, is so many of us are so freaking stagnant in our life. We haven't done anything outside of our comfort zone in years and we wonder why we're not feeling good. I think it's the human need to push and grow and improve and help other people and all this stuff. And all those emotions and progress, all that progress comes on the other side of realizing the mountain isn't up here. Mountain's right here, and it's called starting.
Yeah.
That's it.
So with health and physical health, would you, is it an oversimplification to say that there's like the two main aspects of eating healthy and exercising? Is that an oversimplification? Would you agree with that?
No, I would say it's good to keep things simple. And a reason why a lot of people also don't start is because we think it's complicated. And there's so many options of everything to do. That we get it into our head that, oh, well, we don't know the perfect way to do it, so I won't start.
So real quick, so I read an article about that this past week in regards to eating. And they were saying that there's so much discussion about whether eating keto is the best or vegetarian is the best or vegan is the best. And everybody is so passionate about theirs because they've done theirs and they've seen success. And so the point of the article is like, you're going to see success in all the things because the thing that is similar in all of these is that you're not eating a lot of the processed food and all of the packaged food from fast food and stuff like that. You're cutting all of that out in all of these. And so that's why they're all eating success.
Absolutely.
So you'd agree with that?
Yes. I would agree with that point of people who cut out all of the majority of the bad stuff, like refined like grains, added sugar, tons of processed food, packaged food. If you just do that and focus on whole foods in general, you're going to feel way, way better. But then there's little tweaks that can be made over time as far as being optimal. So there's like absolute optimal human performance and optimal exercise and optimal food. And then there's also just significantly better than you are right now.
Yeah.
Which may not be optimal.
Yeah.
But you kind of got to find what works for you.
And is it fair to like find something in that range that is doable and practical for you?
Yes.
It's like I could shoot for optimal, but I might hate my life.
Yeah. So you would for about 4 days. Yeah. I think a key here is self-awareness. Self-awareness is absolutely crucial when it comes to making these changes because you have to know, am I the kind of person who is all or nothing or can I find a middle ground and stay there, right? Where I am, I'm an all or nothing person and I know that, which is why I had to go optimal with my food, which is why the withdrawals were so bad because I made such a huge switch. It's fine to like wean off of French fries or wean off of your soda, you know, and stuff like that's great, but you have to know yourself to realize what avenue might be best for you to go about. I think that there's a ton of like really healthy, successful, motivated people who are eating healthy 80% and eating treats and going out to eat and having drinks and stuff 20%. And that's actually a great ratio. If you can keep that and not let that pull you to slowly be like, oh, now it's 50-50 and now it's 80-20 the other way. And once every 3 months I'll have a salad because I feel pressured to. Like that's the danger of keeping that 20%.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Totally.
Yeah.
So how would you recommend, obviously meal planning and meal prepping is a huge part
mm-hmm.
of it.
Mm-hmm.
How do you recommend doing it if you don't have the buy-in from like your partner?
So you're like a spouse or,
yeah, like a spouse.
Someone's like not in on it?
Yeah, spouse or even kids, or if you live with your parents or...
Well, first of all, I would say that if you have a spouse that is actively pushing against you from doing it because you've communicated to them that you want to be healthier, that's a bigger issue. Because you need to talk, you need to figure out your relationship because you should have a spouse that wants the best for you. And if it's like a thing of, hey, I just want to be healthier, I want to try this thing, and they say, no, that's a terrible idea, what are you thinking? Mm-hmm. That's, you got to figure out your relationship so that you have somebody that supports you. That's first of all. The other thing is, it's going to be way tougher to not have the support, but you can still do it. Mm. You can bring your own food in. Probably the hardest thing that I think that people still do are moms who are also wives who work full time, who do not have the support of their husband.
Oh man.
And they have kids that are picky. Yeah. So that combination, I do know people like that who will make two dinners. They make one for them and they make one for their husband and their kids.
Yeah.
The other thing you can do, which is more of a struggle, is it's just a mental hurdle of, you know, being courageous is saying, I'm doing this for me. So you can get on board or not. I'm going to make dinner for us and it's going to be what I want to eat. If you don't want it, feel free to order takeout, but I'm eating this for dinner. Mm. And I think I like that slightly better, but everyone has different relationships and all that stuff. I'm not going to assume anything, but I think that's your two options. You either add, you know, you make more food, or you just say, this is what's happening. If you're not on board, then figure it out for yourself because I'm still making food for us.
Yeah.
I've actually, along those lines, I think most people would be surprised at how good tasting nutritious food is.
Oh yeah.
You know, you put on the right oils and the right spices and you cook it the right way. Delicious.
Mm-hmm.
And the return on investment is massive. You can see in like my excitement and passion and just my like overall joy right now is like, it is worth every extra penny and every extra minute that goes into preparing it. It's not even close.
So my one pet peeve though, is when people try to make unhealthy dishes with healthy ingredients.
Uh-huh.
And it, cause it doesn't taste the same.
No.
And it doesn't taste as good.
I've learned this too over the years.
But like if you make just like its own like healthy dish that's its own thing, it's really good.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
Like there are some things like just fruits are like delicious. Yeah. You could do an apple and like some almond butter.
Yeah.
Delicious.
So good.
Right. But if you're going to have a birthday and you're like, someone's like, hey, I'm going to make you cake. Let them make you the nastiest as far as like health wise, like the most delicious, unhealthy cake, because that's what the ceremony or what the situation calls for. Shireen's actually made me cheesecake every year since we met for my birthday.
Aww.
It's kind of like a tradition now. She makes me a cheesecake. So one year, cause she loves me and she knows I was trying to be healthy, she made me a dairy-free, gluten-free cheesecake. Gluten-free, she's done and she still does and it's great.
Really?
Gluten-free crust and stuff, fantastic. Mm. It's actually because they've come a long way because so many people are gluten-free. You can't make a good dairy-free cheesecake. It's in the name. Cheese is in there. It wasn't like I couldn't eat it, but it was I'd rather have anything else, basically. And it's not her fault. She tried to make it without
the
dairy
in it. She tried to do it. No. Yeah.
So I was just like, hey, if we're going to make cheesecake next time, let's just make the cheesecake.
Yeah.
So that's my, whatever I give into that.
Yeah. That makes sense. So what should, I know a lot of
concession.
People,
that was the word I was looking for. That's my concession. Yeah.
There's a lot of people that listen and watch our podcast that are guys and husbands, who don't necessarily do the cooking and stuff.
Sure.
So is it just that now you just got to start doing the cooking if you don't have them?
So one thing, if I don't get exactly to your point, remind me of it, but this is along those lines. One thing that's super helpful about what I offer to like gym members is the meal plan is so clear and succinct and simple.
Anybody can do
you it. Can't screw it up.
Like recipes.
Yeah. So it's the, yeah. Okay, week one, here's your grocery shopping list. Mm-hmm. Just go to around the store and get it all. Boom, 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 boom. You don't even have to think. You just show up and you grab it. That's it. Then it gives you a layout of the what to eat and when. Breakfast, lunch, dinner, snack. The whole week. Okay, this is for breakfast. How do I make it? Here's the recipe. Mm-hmm. Oh, do I have everything I need to make it? Yes, because you went grocery shopping already. You have everything you need for the whole week. So you never have to go back to the store on a random Wednesday night at 7 p.m. because what's for dinner? What do we want to eat? Oh, we don't have this one thing. It's you have it all. You know how to make it. The recipe's there. It's very simple. And then it's also tasty, nutritious, and you don't have to question and wonder every time you're eating, mm-hmm. Well, is this the optimal thing for me? Yep. Mm. Well, what about, yep. Mm-hmm. Just make it like that. Yeah, but what about, yep. Yeah, so you'd see the instructions? 450. So the four is right here. Like, and intentionally, like trying to make it super simple, yeah. Try to make it as simple as possible so that it is easy to follow. To come back to your point, you could do either one. You could say, hey, I'm ready for a change. I have this list that's going to make it easier on you, my spouse, so that you don't have to think and stress. And what am I going to get at the store? Is this good for us? All these things. It is good for us. Just get the list. What's for dinner? You don't even have to think. Because so many times a big stress at 4 p.m. is, what are we going to eat?
Yeah.
Good. You don't have to worry. Boom. It's right there. Mm-hmm. Oh, how do I make it? Boom, right there. Do I have the stuff? Yep, boop, you already bought it. So it's taking all of the stress away for planning, worrying, you know, what are we going to do for this? It's done. So with that, you could either do that yourself because it's so simple, mm-hmm. and say, hey, I got the reins. I want to make this change. And that's almost like guarantee that your spouse is on board because now that I don't have the stress of making dinner anymore. Yeah. Or you could say, you do a great job. I want to make this change and I'm going to make it easier for you by giving you all of the steps so you don't have to even plan. So yeah. No more planning for you. Yay.
Yeah.
And then another tip I offer people is make more than you need to eat that night so that it's a super quick leftovers, mm-hmm. for either lunch or dinner the next day. So you save time that way.
Mm-hmm. So that is that part is a little hard for me.
Which part?
The making more than you need for
okay.
that night.
Okay.
Because I don't know if it's just how I grew up, not really even how I grew up because we didn't do that growing up, but just how we've done since we've been married is you just eat the whole meal.
Mm.
And so if you make a lot, you're eating a lot. Mm. You eat a lot.
Yeah. So that's going to have to be a shift one way or the other.
Yeah.
It's going to have to be a planning of once I get these portions. So there's also portion sizes as part of the meal plan. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was like meat is
really
this.
Helpful.
You know, vegetables is as much as you want. Fruit is this. The oils you use is this. And it's all using just your hand, mm-hmm. which is another simplification because there's so many meal plans or diet plans where you have to count calories. You have to count macros. You have to, it has to fit in some certain whatever. It's none of that. It's just your hand, which you have at all mm-hmm. times. And
there's like the pictures and the diagrams.
Yeah.
Of like, yeah. It's awesome.
So every food group, mm-hmm. you have a certain amount. So you have to just do that and then you're done.
Yeah.
And you're hungry, drink some more water, have a snack.
Yeah.
Healthy snack, whatever. Yeah. Pack the rest away. Or you just make less. You make that exact amount and then mm-hmm. you got to cook more.
Yeah, and then
but at least then you're not overeating.
Yeah. Yeah. It makes total sense.
Yeah. So again, comes back to self-awareness. Mm-hmm. So that's good that you know that because then you can say, okay, we need to do one of these two things to fix it. Or make a change if you're ready to or want to.
I think the hard thing for people to get over is just kind of the routine of eating.
Yes.
And so
routine is huge.
So people will just eat because they're used to eating at that time.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, even if it's just like a big thing for a lot of people to do is once you get the kids in bed, you eat a snack.
Mm-hmm.
And that's routine.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't do it because you're hungry.
Mm-hmm.
you just do it because that's mm-hmm. the time that you're supposed to eat, or mm-hmm. Even eating meals at certain times mm-hmm. because it's routine. You're not really hungry.
Absolutely.
You just do it. So would you say that it's better to just eat when you're hungry?
Yes.
Even if you're eating healthy?
Yes. Mm. You mean even if you're eating unhealthy?
No, even if like I'm on this healthy plan.
Yeah.
If I'm not hungry for breakfast, is it better for me to eat a healthy breakfast or to not eat breakfast?
I say your body is really smart. Listen to your cues. So if anybody who's eating to lose weight, eat when you're hungry. If you're not hungry, don't eat. Keep it that simple. Mm-hmm. On the meal plan, there's breakfast, lunch, and dinner just because most people are used to that.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't eat breakfast. Okay.
Yeah.
Lunch and dinner. Oh, do I need to push breakfast back to... Nope. Just have lunch and dinner. Eat when you're hungry. If you're not hungry, don't eat. And when you do eat, drink water with it so it helps fill you up. And eat till you're about 75% full instead of 100% full.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we don't realize is our stomach takes a second to say, oh, there's food in here, we're full.
Mm.
And most of us, not everybody, but a lot of us will just bum, 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 the food is so good,
yeah.
and we're so excited to be eating,
yeah.
that we'll think we're 100% full. We're really 120% full, and then we're like, oh, God, what have I done? It was so good, I shouldn't have eaten. Yeah, you're right, you shouldn't have.
yeah.
So stop at 75% full.
Mm.
And then if you're still hungry later, have a snack or something. Mm-hmm. But yes, if you're not hungry, don't eat. If you are hungry, eat until you're 75% full instead of all the way.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like I'm just playing devil's advocate with a lot of
Let's
stuff.
Let's go, bring
just,
it.
Well, just I'm just thinking of a lot of the reasons that I've had and yeah. that a lot of people have.
Yep.
And probably the biggest one that I've had is the financial aspect. Mm-hmm. And so... I mean, I think it's fair to say that healthy food costs more than unhealthy food.
Sometimes.
Okay. So, I mean, so early on in our marriage, we were broke.
Mm-hmm.
And so we legitimately, like, we ate spaghetti, like, every night because
yeah.
all we could afford was
yeah.
spaghetti noodles and spaghetti sauce.
Yeah.
And that's all we could afford.
Yeah.
And so how do you, on a limited budget,
mm-hmm.
how do you still make healthy choices?
Okay. So if, I'll start with the caveat of if you are, all we can afford is a 99 cent of spaghetti noodles and a 99 cent bottle or jar of pasta sauce, then you're probably stuck there, mm-hmm. right? You can add eggs,
mm-hmm.
right? Because eggs are cheap. However, do you ever go out to eat?
Yeah.
Do you ever eat fast food?
Mm-hmm.
You're overpaying for food that's not nutritious.
Yeah.
Okay. You go to the grocery store, you look for chicken thighs, whatever. Okay. It's 10 bucks, but yeah, but you've got 12 chicken thighs in there or whatever, mm-hmm. right? And you're eating for however many days, or that's however many meals. You think of one burger, fries, and a drink from like Culver's or McDonald's or something. Most places now you're looking at 10, 12, 13 bucks for one meal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Rotisserie chicken at Costco is $5. Mm-hmm. That's going to feed you, your wife, and probably your
Dude,
kids.
That's a steal.
I'm telling you.
Like rotisserie chicken at Costco mm-hmm. is a steal.
Okay.
Is it weird to just have that for a meal?
No.
I've like always thought about this. Like I could go to McDonald's and spend $8-$9 on a meal,
mm-hmm.
or I could go just get a rotisserie chicken
That's right.
and barbarically eat it.
Just tearing it apart. Yeah. No, that's fine. We have all these.
It would be way more delicious.
We have all these. It would be.
So good.
We have all these preconceived notions of what food should be and what meals should be. It's all silly. You know that breakfast is the most important meal of the day was sponsored by Kellogg's.
You're kidding me.
Nope. You can look it
Don't
up.
Don't even.
It was Kellogg's was like, we need to sell more cereal. Hey, here's $1 million for all of you scientists. Make up a study that says breakfast is the most important meal of the day and we'll put it in our ads. Yeah.
Is it done in the happened. 20s?
Yeah.
Because that's what your accent is.
Yeah. See? Kellogg's. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Exactly true.
No
there was another
way.
One where they paid, I think it was, there was another study that was paid scientists to say that sugar is not that bad for you. and it was sugar companies. So anytime you're looking at like data and things like that, or like headline reading, mm-hmm. you have to see who funded these studies. Because if there's a study that says milk gives you strong bones and it's funded by big dairy, do you think mm-hmm. that all of their data was accurate?
Yeah.
Or was it skewed slightly because they got paid a big buttload, you know? Yeah. So
the first thing that comes to mind was like the Subway diet that,
mm-hmm.
that, well, the spokesperson, that's their own story.
Yeah, I'm right.
But there had to be some validity to it, was there? I mean, there had to be like...
That's probably one of those things where he was eating so poorly. You saw how big he was before.
Yeah, beforehand.
And then you're adding, you know, some meats and vegetables and stuff.
And just limiting how much he was eating.
Yeah, probably. So this is an important point. I have two things. Real quick, weight, only weight, not health, just weight, is calories only. Okay. So most of us are kind of roughly here when we don't gain or lose weight. Okay. Calories in, calories out. All right. A 200 pound person that has more muscle mass than a different 200 pound person who doesn't have as much muscle mass is going to burn more calories during the day doing the exact same things, because the more muscle we have, it burns fat, or it burns calories more than fat does. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if ways to adjust these things are how much you eat brings calories up or down, how much you exercise and how much muscle mass you have brings your metabolism, we'll just call it, up or down. Okay. So how much you're burning.
Mm-hmm.
If you're sedentary all day, you know, it's pretty low. If you're exercising a lot and you're putting muscle on, it's going up. So you can, if you eat the same, you'll lose weight.
Mm.
If you eat slightly less, you lose even more weight, right? So you want to be able to put on muscle mass to help burn more calories easier. So you're making it like more coal in the fire to like burn hotter, mm-hmm. furnace kind of thing. So you'll burn more calories the more muscle you have. And if you add exercise on top of that, you'll burn more calories that day. And if you eat slightly less calories, you're also intaking less. Mm. The problem with me even saying any of this is people will go to the extreme and say, people will starve themselves. It's like, okay, you have an eating disorder. Please don't do that.
Yeah.
Just one scoop instead of two scoops.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So it's only calories.
What food group were you talking about when you mentioned scoops?
Sweet potato mashed.
Mm, that's what I was picturing too.
Yeah. Legitimately. Mashed sweet potatoes.
Yeah.
Really good.
Real quick.
Yes.
Sweet potatoes are so good.
Cool.
I didn't know I liked sweet potatoes.
Yeah. I like them
until one of your food plans. And now one of my favorite breakfasts is legitimately like sliced broiled sweet potato with avocado.
I love
it.
So good. We don't know how tasty healthy food is because we're stuck on like artificial sweeteners and crap.
And I mean, you've blown my mind with this, but like breakfast is like so much better healthy.
I love, dude.
Healthy
breakfast brunch
is
amazing.
So much better than unhealthy breakfast.
Oh, yeah. I agree.
All right. Sorry.
Anyways.
Do you remember where you were?
Well, I had a second point that I wanted to go to, which kind of comes back to the cost. Mm. You're talking about the financial side of it. So let's not look at the actual cost for a second. Let's look at purchasing nutrition.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So let's say the nutritional value of a McDonald's breakfast is like a 2 out of 10. Okay. And the nutritional value of a breakfast you make at home is a 9 out of 10. Mm-hmm. And the McDonald's breakfast is $12. And the food you bought for breakfast at home is, let's just say $15. I think it'd actually be comparable, mm-hmm. honestly. But just for argument, we'll make it worse and say homemade breakfast is $15. But you're getting a 9 out of 10 nutrition mm-hmm. versus a 2 out of 10 nutrition. One of the things that Dr. Siz says, so he's the owner of Eupraxia. He started Eupraxia, the gym that I own. And he says that the majority of Americans are overfed and undernourished.
Mm.
So our bodies, again, are smart. We need a certain amount of all the vitamins, minerals, proteins, fats, carbs, all these things. We need a certain amount. We're eating empty calories in almost all of the packaged, highly processed foods. The nutrition isn't in it. right? It's just calories and it's just added sugar and it's just high fructose corn syrup and red dye 40 and all this stuff. So we're eating and our body is like, that wasn't it. First of all, that was delicious. So if you want more, please, please give us some more. But I'm still hungry because I didn't get any nutrition that I needed. Versus you eat like a steak and you're like, oof, that was good. I'm set. And you just feel satiated, right? Because you're getting the proteins and the fats and stuff that you need and all the nutrients that you need. Or if you're a vegetarian, you know, you eat a big salad, you're like, oof, that was good.
So, just because I want to understand more, I'm going to push back a little bit.
Please.
Is that because I feel like a sandwich or like, I feel like bread fills me up way more than like carrots.
Yeah.
Is that true? Or am I, is that just convincing myself of that?
It's, I don't know how that works. I don't think so. Like what kind of bread, I guess? Well, like
I don't know.
Sandwich,
I just always had this thought in this mentality.
What are you eating your bread? Are you eating raw bread? Well, that's no, a
but just like carbs in general. I've just felt like feel like carbs fill me up and keep me full longer than like a salad.
The majority of like what's like science would say, as far as like research on the macros, would say that fat and protein are way more satiating than carbs are. And the thing is, actually, salad is carbs. Mostly carbs. So vegetables are actually carbs.
Okay. I would agree with you that like eating a steak is going to keep me way more full than any of it probably. Yeah, that makes sense.
And that's a decent possibility that it's just your brain saying that so that you can eat more carbs.
Yeah.
Be like, but Pete, what I think is this.
If I eat this bowl of pasta, I'll never be hungry again.
Well, and the thing is like you think, oh, well, the pasta is what's filling me up. It's no, it's you're eating so much pasta that, you cannot be full because of all that pasta you had. You know, if we look at the serving sizes of like the majority of the world and compare it to America, we're eating for a family of five. Yeah. Most of us are. And then, you know, so it's the portion sizes are huge. So we're usually eating more carbs and maybe you do feel full, but you're probably having comparatively calories wise and stuff, you're probably eating more of it and then you're saying you're full. That's my guess.
Dude, I love how passionate you are about this right now.
Yeah.
I know there's like times that we talk where you're not as passionate about it.
Yeah.
So I can tell that it's like, dude, I can tell.
And it's because I'm feeling so good.
Yeah.
That it's a reminder because when I've been, so I have now been very much on the polar opposite of eating all of the junk food I want, drinking whenever I want, having some nicotine from time to time to boost my energy, you know, not exercising, skipping workouts, and then the polar opposite, eating super optimal for human health and nutrition, taking those sacrifices to like go to the grocery store and make stuff, prepare food, whatever. It's really not that hard once you get in the rhythm of it. It's just the first starting part. Exercising regularly. And I feel this is a 2, this is a 12 out of 10. Like amazing difference that I get so excited to like I mentioned before, now I remember why I did this, dude.
Yeah.
Like I started the gym because I wanted to give this to as many people as I can because it is the way that we need to live to crush everything else. Forget the vanity of I want six packs. Forget that. What is your job? Oh, you're in sales? You know how you're going to make more sales? When you have vitality and you wake up early, you get a good workout in, and now your endorphins are just rushing and you feel good. You're confident about yourself.
Yeah.
How, you know, like whatever your field is, you're going to be better if you're healthier because your brain is going to be quicker. You're going to think more clearly. You're going to have more self-confidence. You're going to have more energy.
Yeah.
And all these things. And I forget that when I'm over here because I'm in a funk and my brain is not firing on all cylinders. Cause it's like I'm putting diesel in a regular, you know, engine.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's the wrong fuel. So it's slowed down and it's clunky and it's, oh, I need a nap and it's, I don't like myself. And any little hiccup that comes up during your day, you're like, oh, wouldn't it just be better if this just was all over? Yeah. And it's like, that's not how we're meant to function.
Yeah.
It's wrong. And not, I'm not saying morally wrong, but it's not correct as far as what we should be doing to crush life. And I just want people to crush life.
Yeah. Yeah, without a doubt. I think the biggest motivator for me that I need to reengage is because I put so much value in being a dad.
Mm-hmm.
I love being a dad.
Mm-hmm.
And when I am eating healthier and exercising more, I have so much more energy with my kids.
Yeah.
To play with my kids.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, that's a huge motivator for me. I just need to reengage it and reprioritize it.
I think you just did.
Boom.
That's it, dude. Yeah. And it's the, it is, addiction is sometimes skimmed over in situations like this. Cause we're like, oh, it's just food. It's like, no, like if you're serious, dude, mm-hmm. you're going to go through a wave of time like I did at the beginning of this, mm-hmm. where you're going to have that voice in your head mm-hmm. that's saying it's not worth it. Pete doesn't know what he's talking about. I'm better off when I'm eating the way that I have been. I don't have time. My kids mm-hmm. love me anyways. What's the point? This hurts. It's not worth it. All mm-hmm. of those things are going to real heavy for like a full week maybe.
Yeah.
And it's your job as a responsible father who wants to be that guy mm-hmm. and says that's his priority mm-hmm. to meet it with your actions Good. For 1 week and push through that so that on the other side, you feel like this.
Yeah.
Because you've seen me low, dude.
Yeah.
And I'm not low because I give total credit, one, to God.
Yeah.
But two, to how I've been treating my body for the last, it's been 11 days.
Yeah.
How fast does 11 days go?
Seriously.
It's over.
Yeah.
The problem is that mountain of feeling bad for a week.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So. Yeah. Well, I hope this has been encouraging to you too. And that this is going to, I don't know, maybe change how you live too. There's so much more so many more questions and so many more excuses and objections I have. So maybe next time we talk, we'll keep talking about it.
I'd be happy to. And we can get more into like what healthy food actually looks like.
That'd be great
too.
I'd love it.
Sure.
Thanks for listening, guys. If you have any questions or thoughts, make sure you let us know.
Appreciate you.
Love you.
Bye.
Bye.